Good evening. We're going to get started. Where are all my hockey fans at tonight?
All right, who went to Fort Wayne and who said that they sucked? Anybody? Oh, I see a couple up there.
Welcome to Iceman Live.
That's true, they do suck if we're there or not. So yes, we do not love Fort Wayne around here. But all right, you started off. Sorry, I wanted to start.
You had to get that in right away.
I had to get that in. I had to start chirping about Fort Wayne.
Welcome to another edition of Iceman Live. We are glad to be here at Beef O'Brady in Newburgh. I'm John Peterson. This is Brian Ball.
Howdy, y'all.
This is a big week as the season opener now is less than a week away. Saturday night at the Ford Center, the Indy Fuel are in town. Our in-state rivals, so we're looking forward to seeing all you guys and a lot of fans out there to support the Icemen as we hit the ice for the first time in a game that counts. As even though we lost both games in Fort Wayne, the good news is those games don't count for anything.
We're still undefeated.
And we're excited about Saturday night. We hope you are too. We've got a lot to cover on the show tonight. We are also streaming live for the second time on our website, our new broadcast platform this year. Right there at EvansvilleIcemen.com. Free streaming, so you can listen to all home and away games right from our website and also from your mobile device by downloading the MixLR app, and we'll get you more info on that, but we're excited.
I'll tell you what, it's really exciting with the MixLR. Actually, we had 30 people listen to us last week on the broadcast, so that was actually really cool. So we had 30 people listen to us, so actually we're able to keep stats of who's listening and who's not listening. So we had over 30 people tune in to listen to Iceman Live.
And that was without promoting it at all. I think we announced that we were doing that the day of the show, probably an hour before we went on the show. So the good news is the word got out a little bit right away, and now we're anticipating those numbers to go way up. But
so all of our people in computer land, thanks for tuning in tonight to talk a little hockey.
See a lot of familiar faces out there here at Beef O'Brady. Thank you for coming down and watching the show tonight. We have three players on the show tonight we'll talk to and get to know a little bit more. We've got Justin McDonald, who was a part of the Icemen last year. Towards the end of the year, he'll be talking with us. Also Mark Anthoyne, who was a part of the Icemen late last year.
AKA Mr. Gray.
And we have Matthew Zay, who is new to the Icemen this year. So thank you guys for stopping down to Beef O'Brady. We look forward to those interviews on the show. We're going to talk a little bit about the Ottawa Senators. Their season is underway in the NHL. They've got three games under their belt already. Our affiliates up there in Ottawa. Our affiliate in Binghamton won their season opener. So that's good news for the Binghamton Senators. And we'll talk a little bit about that. And we have some breaking news to get to here in a second that I literally just got off the phone with our assistant coach, Johan Lundskog. Some breaking Iceman news coming up here in just a second. Brian, though, you have some Where Are They Now to get us started on the show.
Yeah, basically one big Where Are They Now. Former Iceman player Tristan King today was traded from Missouri to Allen, Texas for Trevor Ludwig. Trevor Ludwig, actually, he's a defenseman who actually has been with the Allen Americans for the past 3 years and helped them win a couple of cups. But there has been a trade there for Tristan King. Also talking a little ECHL hockey this past weekend. It was definitely a preseason. Former Iceman player Nathan Moon had 2 goals over the weekend, so it was great to see Nathan Moon still making some huge success with the Colorado Eagles. Wish you were here, Nathan, but that's okay. Also, Andre Bouvet-Morissette, he actually had 3 goals this weekend as well.
Very well done on that accent. Yes. Or on the pronunciation, I should say.
I'll tell you what, with him being here for the last couple of years, I actually picked up that pretty well. Also, Dylan Clark did have 1 goal on Sunday for the Indy Fuel, so we'll actually be seeing former Iceman player Dylan Clark coming up this weekend. So even though he was a fan favorite there, we got to give him a little love, you know, this weekend. And like Jack just said, sucks. So we'll have to definitely send some love that way. Going over talking about some of the players that are over in Europe right now. Phil Buschbacher, who's actually an Iceman player that came in sort of towards the end of last year. He's played for Moliga. Anyways, for 10 games, he's had 6 goals, 6 assists. And 12 points. Jacob Johnson, who's then playing for the Edinburgh Capitals of the EIHL. Was a former defenseman here, played for one season with the Icemen, out 13 games, had 2 goals, 10 assists. Miles Bell, who's playing with Stjern in Norway, with 8 games played, 8 goals, 3 assists. Also, Brandon Pym is playing for EC Kassel Huskies in the German 2 League. Out of 8 games played, has 4 goals and 5 assists. And I tell you what, Becky always, she loves those All-American Hockey League days, so I always got to bring these up. Former Iceman players, Kyle Heffernan and Shane Heffernan, that is playing that same league as Bill Buschbacher, that Mo League. Kyle Heffernan has had out of 7 games, has 5 goals and 3 assists. And Shane Heffernan, his brother, has out of 9 games, has 3 goals, 5 assists. Also, some other news to look at. Also, it's nice. It's amazing to see, you know, Wade McLeod, who was actually an all-star for last year for the Idaho Steelheads, and who played just a little bit here in Evansville. He's in that German 2 League as well with Braden Pym. Out of 8 games played, he has 4 goals and 3 assists. So, actually, Braden Pym has actually put up more points than him. And Stefan Del Rovere has played in the Italy League. Stefan, he was the captain last year for the Orlando Solar Bears. But now he's playing in the Italy League. Out of 8 games played, has 4 goals and 2 assists. And let's talk about a little bit about some goaltending. You know how I like my goalies. Just noticed today that Alan York, former Iceman goaltender Alan York, who's actually was signed by Syracuse in the offseason, he actually got assigned this past week to the Greenville Swamp Rabbits. So Alan York is a Greenville Swamp Rabbit now. He's going to be hopping along on the bunny trail. So Alan is there now. It looks like Mike Clemente got released out of the Danish League. So Mike Clemente has been released. He's no longer active on the roster, so I'm going to try to dig in and find out some information next week about Mike Clemente. Looking here, Cal Heater, he's actually been doing pretty well in that KHL again. Actually, him and Thomas Larkin are playing together on the same team, and there's no way I can pronounce that Russian name, but it's in the KHL. Maybe you can pronounce it.
No chance.
So anyway, that team in the KHL, 6 games, he has a 3.23 goals against and an 85% save percentage, so looks like he's having a little rough time there. So basically, that is where they now. That's a little bit update, but so a lot of moves are coming. Great to see a lot of our Iceman, former Iceman players doing very well. I did see a post the other night about, there people were asking about Langlois, who played here for the Evansville Iceman. He did sign a contract with the San Jose Sharks, but I did see he's with the San Jose Barracudas right now. Has not made his NHL debut, so hopefully maybe that'll be the next Iceman coming up. Someone posted that on the Maniacs Asylum. I checked that out, but I did want to do some research. But no, he has not made the jump up to the San Jose Sharks just yet. But he was also injured a lot for last year, so hopefully maybe he'll make that jump. So that's where it is. All right, go to our breaking news.
All right, so breaking news today involving your Icemen. First of all, you may have seen this earlier today. The Binghamton Senators tweeted out on their official Twitter account that Ryan Penny has been sent to the Evansville Icemen.
Actually, I think Dixie Hadler broke it.
So that's been out now for a few hours. We haven't sent anything official press release-wise yet. We're going to group that together with our other breaking news that I just got word of on the phone. But Ryan is a player that's coming to the Icemen. He's a rookie this year. He played 4 years, I believe. Yeah, 4 full years in the Quebec Major Junior Hockey League and put up some big numbers last year in, I believe you say it's pronounced Ruin Noranda, but... He played 66 games and had 70 points in juniors in a very competitive major junior league in Canada. 32 goals, 38 assists. He was in Binghamton's camp, but he hasn't seen any action in their one regular season game, and they didn't see him getting into a lot of games in the early going up there in Binghamton this season, so instead of having him sit on the bench, they thought it was good to get him to Evansville to play some hockey and play in some games. So we're excited to have Ryan Penny and the coaches. I talked to Coach Sims and Coach Lundskog earlier today, and they're excited about what he'll bring to the table as well.
Well, I definitely know one thing is I was talking with in the beginning of training camp, they were really a little bit disappointed that they might not get Penny because Penny was doing so well during the preseason games for Bingo that he was not going to come down here. They're actually very excited right now to get him.
So he'll be playing his first career professional hockey game for the Icemen. It might not be the opener, depending on when he gets into town. It may be the Back to the Future night on October 24th, but we'll see. Perhaps because he was in training camp with them, I don't want to tease anything that we can't talk about, but maybe Matt Zay over there might know a little bit about Ryan's game, having been in training camp with the Senators. We'll ask him about it. I personally have never seen him play, so I don't know what he'll bring to the table exactly, but I don't know, maybe Matt knows something I don't, having been in camp with Ryan Penny up there in Binghamton.
Maybe have some stuff that you could tell us, secret stuff that a lot of us don't know, so when you bring him on the show, that we have some information.
Yeah, well, we got to get to know Matt too, because a lot of us haven't met Matt yet, so we'll bring him on here in just a little bit. The other breaking news that I just got official word on, the Icemen have signed a former NHL and AHL forward by the name of Matt Hussey, and he's from New Haven, Connecticut. He played high school hockey briefly in Minnesota, so I had that Minnesota connection with him right out of the gate. I met him on Sunday. Talked about our favorite towns in Minnesota, favorite things to do. He is a 36-year-old forward.
Hold on. There's stuff to do in Minnesota?
Not much, but there's a few things. The Mall of America is there.
What, you guys go sledding? Build snowmen?
Yeah, well, in the winter, it's pretty bad. A lot worse than here. But some of these Canadians know it worse than I do up in Minnesota. It's pretty bad up there, but Matt's going to bring some leadership and some experience to the Icemen. He's actually never played an ECHL game, but he played in over 300 AHL games, and he played 21 NHL games for the Pittsburgh Penguins and the Detroit Red Wings. And he has 4 career NHL points, a couple hundred AHL career points, 167 actually AHL points in 381 games. So he played for the Wilkes-Barre Scranton Penguins for a while when Coach Sims was there. So that's how he has that connection to Coach Al Sims. He spent the last 6 years of his playing career in Germany, playing professionally for a couple different teams in Germany. But he'll be joining the Icemen here, and I assume he'll be in the lineup on Saturday night, but we'll see when the official lineup is announced.
Yeah, I sort of like this pickup because Fort Wayne sort of did this, I think it was either last year or 2 years ago, when they were looking for some leadership, some veteran leadership. They went and got that, I think it was Shane, Zaleski? But anyways, he was an older player that played, but had a lot of experience and actually could put a lot of goals in the net. Sort of nice thing is that this guy's going to definitely put the puck in the back of the net. It'd be great to ask of the boys here, because I know he's been skating with them at least first practice today. So,
well, a big thing too is a lot of people have mentioned how many rookies are on this team, and when we hit the ice in Fort Wayne on Friday, there were 9 rookies in the lineup, and that's not a bad thing. It's good to have that youth, but it's nice to have a couple leaders in the locker room as well that have been in the pro ranks for a long time. Jarrett Lucan obviously has been playing pro hockey for a while now, and now Matt Hussey comes in too. So it'll be nice to see what he brings to the table. He last played for the Nuremberg Thomas Sabo Ice Tigers in Germany, and then spent the last year up in Minnesota, staying on the ice but not playing professionally. His best career year was back with the Wilkes-Barre Scranton Penguins in 05-06. He had 21 goals and 31 assists that year in 65 games. So I'm sure we'll get a chance to talk to Matt either next week or maybe the week after here on the show. Get to know him a little bit better, but that was the breaking news. Obviously, again, a lot of you math majors or people that are a little bit better with math than I am are probably thinking training camp roster has to get down to 23 by opening day, and so we had to make a few more cuts this week. Oh, we get some runs scored here in the baseball game.
Boo!
Oh, you're a Cubs fan, aren't you?
I'm a Cubs fan.
Cardinals
like
fans are clapping. It's 1-1. We had to make a few cuts after we got back from Fort Wayne. Obviously, we never like to do it. It's never fun. So we wish these guys the best, but they definitely deserve their time as far as mentioning the fact that they did a good job in camp and they were part of this group. But they were cut this week, and Matt Harlow, one of them, is officially a rookie this year. He played in a few games for Elmira last year after his college career ended at Brown University. Matt was a part of the whole camp. He signed with the Icemen in the offseason. So we wish him the best. Radoslav Ilo also cut. He played at Bemidji State University and played in Slovakia professionally last year. From my understanding, he's heading back to Slovakia, at least for the time being, to figure out where he's going to play this year. J.P. Lombardo played for the Gwinnett Gladiators, now the Atlanta Gladiators. He played there last year, and the Icemen signed him this summer. But J.P. was one of the four that were waived after our Fort Wayne trip. And then Robin Sudek is probably the most surprising, I think, to some of the fans, at least who weren't in training camp. He has quite a bit of experience at the pro level, played in Rapid City last year from the Czech Republic. And I think, you know, for Robin and for a lot of people that follow this team closely, they thought he was a virtual lock maybe to make the team. But as you know, there's a lot of talent that we talked about in this training camp. A lot of players, I think, that are going to contribute and do good things for the Icemen this year. And the coaches have their plan in place. And Robin was unfortunately let go. So we wish him the best as well. I think he's heading back to the Czech Republic for the time being.
Well, I tell you what, a lot of changes, but I tell you what, you know, seeing those major names shows you that the talent level that we have this hockey season, and you know, a lot of great things to come. And like I said, you know, one thing is, I think a lot of people saw during the blue-white game, this team has a lot of speed. It's a very fast team, and I think that's what's going to be really fun and exciting to watch is we're going to be a very, very, very fast team this season.
And speaking of speed, got a couple players. Maybe Matt Zay wants to join us first. That come up and do an interview. We've got a lot of speed, as we've talked about on both shows so far this year. The coaches have mentioned it in interviews with the local media. It's gonna be a little bit different watching these guys out there on the ice than we've seen in the past, and that hopefully will work out to our advantage. Never a bad thing to have a lot of speed. And Matt Zay, one of those that has joined the Icemen recently, hasn't been in the full training camp, but has taken part in the last week or so, including our two games in Fort Wayne. And we welcome Matthew Zay to the broadcast. Welcome, Matt.
Hey, how you doing? Glad to be here.
We're glad to have you. Oh, I turned my own mic up. Let's turn yours up. There we go. I'm a rookie over here. So are you, but welcome to Evansville. What's your experience been like so far here in Evansville at training camp and getting out there on the ice with the guys?
It's been a great experience. I mean, ever since we arrived in Evansville last week, Al and Johan have me in a good setup and have just helped me out. And I'm excited to be at the Ford Center and playing in front of some great fans this year.
Talk about what your experience in Binghamton in training camp has done for your game and what those coaches have kind of taught you as well before you came to Evansville. Obviously, your rookie year after college, you were able to sign with the Senators organization. What kinds of things have they been telling you?
Yeah, after my college season last year, I went and played for Springfield in the American League for 2 weeks, and then they got guys back from injury and whatnot, so then I wanted to go to Binghamton, and they were glad to have me. And then I signed with them during the summer. And they just, you know, Luke Richardson and Randy Lee up there, they preach a strong game, a hard, you know, power forward game for my guy like myself. And I think coming down here, I'd have to, you know, keep doing what I can do and have confidence in myself, and it'll all be all right.
I know some of your goals is you know make it back up, but what are some of your on the ice goals right now that you want to do here in Evansville?
I just want to be responsible defensively as a center in our own end and contribute offensively the way I know I can, whether that's shooting the puck or you know, setting guys up and playing a nice physical game and getting my nose in there and not being afraid to push back at all.
So basically, you're telling us a little bit that you're a player that likes to get a little dirty. Is that true? And Becca, was he getting dirty this week? Was he getting dirty at all in that game? No? Oh, no! The truth comes out. The scout over there says he did not get dirty during the game. Becca's our scout over there, too. She's in the pink. She loves pink, so...
Well, thanks for wrapping me out, Becca. Appreciate it. Yeah, not much to say.
So you're listed at least on Elite Prospects, which I think is probably the best scouting site out there. I use that all the time. But you're listed as a center or a wing. You played center this weekend in Fort Wayne, both games. Do you feel more comfortable there, or is it a matter of need for the Iceman? What have the coaches been telling you?
Throughout my college career, I played center and wing. And up in Binghamton last year and this year, I played more center than I have as the wing. But it's a different game as a wing. You're more getting into the corners more on dumps and you can really lay the body on some guys. As a center, I think you have to be a little more patient, and you have to pick and choose your spots, and you have to be a little more responsible. But I don't really have a preference. Whatever they need me to do, I'm ready to step in.
Obviously, a big part of when the coaches choose the lines is chemistry on a line, and you've kind of been, there's been a lot of experimenting, which I think is typical for training camp, obviously for preseason games. One game this past weekend you played with Lombardo and McDonald, another game you played with Strandberg and Sudek. Any guys that stand out? I think you and Mac had assists on Chris Carlisle's goal on Monday. Have you noticed any chemistry, at least in the practice, with any particular guys that you've been playing with?
I don't know. I mean, I know a guy like Mac. He could score. That's what he does. Anywhere on the ice, he can shoot the puck and kind of put it where it needs to be. I think right now we're even at practices and whatnot. Al and Johan, we're just experimenting with what will work, and trial and error type of thing.
Also, going through training camp, you're meeting the guys and stuff like that. Question, we always like to get a little bit deeper is who are you rooming with, and any things you like rooming with that person, or are they bugging you where you're going to toss them out of the apartment?
I'm rooming right now with Dalton Livillet, I think that's how you say his name, and Joe Zarbo.
Sorry. Don't feel bad, they helped me out last week.
And Joe Zarbo. I roomed with Dalton in Binghamton for a week. He's a nice guy. They're both really good dudes and easy to get along with. Dalton likes to clean, which is great. Cubs just hit a home run.
Yep.
Brian, you can take this moment to clap if you want.
There's no dirt on them. They're both great guys, and we like to cook and watch TV a little bit. Right now the Jays are on, so I'm sure they're trying to watch that. But power's out at our apartment, so I don't know how that's going for them.
Here in Evansville, a lot of folks are Cubs fans, I've noticed, and a lot of folks are Cardinals fans, probably Cardinals a little more predominantly from what I've noticed. I've only been here for a month and a half or so. But in the locker room, it seems like the Blue Jays are the team of choice for a lot of guys. A lot of guys from Ontario, the coaches. Is that fair to say? Is there a good rooting fan base for the Blue Jays?
All of Canada seems to root for the Blue Jays. It really grinds my gears. I don't like that. I think only people from the Toronto area should root for the Blue Jays, and
yep.
Everyone else should have their own team. Like, I'm a Met fan, and the Mets play in about a half hour, and I'm hoping this interview's over by then so I can watch the game.
But. We'll get you out of here before then. Glendale, New York. Where's that at?
That is in Queens.
Okay, so yeah. I know, I have a couple buddies from college that are around the Queens area that are big Mets fans too. Is that pretty much a Mets town, Queens?
Not really. I mean, it's really split, 50-50, I think, all throughout New York. Like, I have half of my good buddies that are my Mets fans, the other half are Yankee fans.
Going to college at Mercyhurst, what was that experience like for you? You were a captain your senior year. As far as the collegiate hockey game, what was that experience like?
Yeah, at Mercyhurst, I don't have a bad thing to say. I really enjoyed my 4 years there, and I wouldn't trade it for anything. And college hockey, it's a different animal for some people because there's only, you know, 36, 40 games, and every game is like game 7 of the Stanley Cup. You know, it's guys are, there's only 2 games a week, and guys are flying around, buzzing around, everyone's getting hit into the boards and open ice, and because you have nothing to save it for, you know, it's 2 games and then you got a week of practice to rest up. And it's not the same, I guess, as playing Major Junior where you play 70 games or whatnot, but those 40 games, they're rough, and I didn't have an injury in my career until I went to college, so.
Yeah, my question is going back a little bit to where you're from the New York area. Coming here, did you know that this is the hometown of Donnie Baseball, big Yankee, former Yankee captain? So, were any of your friends say, hey, you're going to Evansville, hometown of Donnie Baseball?
No, first time I heard that. It's pretty cool though. I like hearing stuff like that.
He lives here and he also comes to games. So.
Oh really? He still lives here?
Yeah, he still lives here. Yeah, he comes from the Dodgers. So.
You gotta let me know when he comes to a game.
We'll definitely make it, let you know.
Do you and our equipment manager Alex Kermitis have a little rivalry with the Yankees and Mets?
There's no rivalry because the Yankees aren't in the playoffs.
Oh, there you go. It was short-lived. I'm not sure if they're listening, but after getting off the phone with Johan, they might be tuning in on our website, so I hope they are. Matt, we're glad to have you. Let's open it up to some questions from the fans out here at Beef O'Brady in Newburgh. If anybody's got anything from Matt Zay, feel free to fire away. Don't all jump at once.
Jack! Question?
Travis? Let's give a shout out to Travis Tornatore, our brains behind the operation here.
Nope.
Me? Okay, I'll turn my mic up. Thank you. I had another question, if I could remember it. Brian?
I got nothing.
Well, Matt, thanks for coming on the show. We appreciate it. We'll get to a couple of your teammates here. Okay, there we go.
Anything you want to tell us before we got Justin McDonald coming on? Any dirt, anything you could tell us now to embarrass him so when he comes up here?
I don't know. I only met him like a few days ago.
I was going to make fun of his weave, but it's in good shape tonight.
He's got some tattoos. Do you want to ask him about that?
Yeah.
That's really it. I don't know. Tattoos, maybe?
All right, we got tattoos.
Tattoos work. You should have seen the hair, though. McDonald was rocking in Fort Wayne for a while there. I think even Johan gave him a hard time. Let's talk to Justin McDonald next. Matt, thank you so much. Appreciate it. Best of luck to you. And,
thank you.
Look forward to seeing you on the ice.
Call me a number.
Let's do a little drawing here before Matt leaves the table.
$10 gift certificate to Played Against Sports.
571-6247.
All right.
Woman. Thank you.
So I got these $10 gift cards to Play Against Sports. Thank you. All right. Coming up next, we have Justin McDonald, who has tattoos. That was weak. Usually you guys are good at chirping each other, you know, you guys got good stories to tell. Maybe it's just still new in the season. Still new. All right, I'm going to pass the mic on to you because John will probably start off the questions.
Mac, Justin McDonald, welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Welcome back. Last year you were called up to the Icemen. About 20 games you played for Evansville after a really good year in the Federal League. I think it was well documented. You led all North American pro hockey players in points at the time. Describe that process for you when you were noticed. Was it Coach Sims, I believe, that brought you up, or describe coming to Evansville after the year you had in the Federal League?
Jim Riggs came and saw me in Danville, which is like 3 hours away from here. He saw me play and then called me after the game, talked to me in the hallway, and was like, "We'd love to have you." And then I had that big passport process that took about a month. And then when I finally came here, I was excited. You know, I wanted to start at a new level and all that. And hopefully I could contribute, and I did all right for the last 20 games.
Had a couple of goals this weekend in Fort Wayne. How are you feeling out there?
It was good to get back on the ice. You know, you train all summer, but it's completely different going to play in an actual game. Got a couple goals and whatnot, but it would have been nice to win. But then again, it's preseason, so.
You want to go with it?
Also, another big thing is you got the Gordy over the weekend. How did that start out? We didn't know you were a fighter.
I didn't know either. It's just, I trained like that in the summertime, just with my trainer and all that over the past few years, and I to work, and it helped, I guess. I didn't lose, I don't think, so no one's made fun of me yet, so hopefully I can bring that throughout the entire 72-game season.
And the last one was the goal, I think, in the second period. I think you and Matt Zay assisted on the Carlisle goal late in the first. And then the fight, walk me through how that happened. We got to keep it PG here, though, on the radio. But the guy gets hauled down for a penalty shot, the Fort Wayne player, and right after they call the penalty shot, it happened behind the net.
Well, I didn't even know. I thought I got a penalty, and I drew the penalty shot, which didn't make any sense to me. But the guy was standing in our crease, and, you know, Al always says whenever there's a guy in the crease, push him out or whatnot. So I did, and then their team came and retaliated, and then one thing led to another. And when I saw the penalty shot, I was questioning why they got a penalty shot, because I hit the guy. But then I found out he got hauled down and all that. Yeah, luckily I came out with a big stop there.
When there are 30 guys in camp and only 23 can make the opening night roster, what's kind of going through your mind as far as things that you need to do to stand out?
You got to stand out from everyone else. You know, if everyone's going to be a goal scorer, you got to do something else. You know, the entire team can't score goals. You need that grinder. If the whole team's grinding, you need someone to score goals. So, even Al says, you know, you got to separate yourself, do what you can do best. And with 30 guys, you definitely got to separate yourself. It's nerve-wracking every day seeing, you know, Zay come down and like 8 other guys come down. But that's the business. You can't really control it. You can only control what you do on the ice. And hopefully I did as much as I can, and hopefully I can stick around for as long as possible.
Say, also during training camp, I got to meet your former coach from Watertown, Brent Clark. He said he taught you everything that you know now?
Not at all. I taught that guy everything he knows.
You won a championship in the Southern Professional League a couple of years ago. What was that experience like to be able to finish the year on top of the league?
That was awesome. Coach was Gary Graham, who's now the coach of Fort Wayne. That was my second year playing semi-pro hockey. So it was unbelievable. I'd never won a championship before. So it was just the thrill of it. All the fans are involved. You know, down in Florida, it's awesome to celebrate it on the beach after. It's awesome to see Gary every now and then whenever playing Fort Wayne, or he comes up to Toronto, which is where I live. So it's awesome to see him, and we always have that friendship off the ice. But when it's on the ice, yeah, it's a different story.
You mentioned Florida. That was in Pensacola, the Ice Flyers, the champions that year, and you got to see Gary this weekend, obviously. Did you have a chance to stop by and talk to him?
Yeah, he was in the hallway, and I happened to walk by, and we just talked a little bit, about how things are going. He runs a fireworks business, so he's talking about that, and he was making fun of my dog, so it's just like good times.
Who has better hair, you or Gary Graham?
We call him a poodle, so I'd have to say him.
Hold on.
Becca, did you get that? I want you to make a sign next time Gary Graham comes here, call him the poodle.
Got it? All right. Not a girl.
So I gave you a hard time about your hair the other day, and I think it was one of the coaches or players. I don't remember. You probably remember better than I do who was giving you a hard time, but this is your chance to dish it back out. Who's got the worst weave on the Iceman?
I'd have to say Calmer. He doesn't have much going on up there at all.
Brandon Calm, I would have expected another forward or something, but he goes goaltender.
Yeah.
Awesome. Justin, let's see here. Newmarket, Ontario. This is my geography failing me again, but you mentioned Toronto's where you're at now. Where's Newmarket in regards to Toronto?
Newmarket's just 25 minutes north of Toronto. Now I live in Markham, which is 20 minutes from Toronto, so it takes, you know, if I want to go downtown or whatever, I just hop on basically Yonge Street and head south for 15, 20 minutes and I'm downtown. So I'm outside the city, but at the same time, it's a booming city that I'm living in, Markham. So it's good that everything's around, but at the same time, there's a lot of traffic and no one likes that. So,
are you pretty much Toronto pro sports across the board, if you had a choice?
Yeah, I am. And like they said it, you know, I'm from Toronto, so I am rooting for the Jays. Not a big Jays, you know, baseball fan in general. But right now, Toronto doesn't have much going for them in sports, so yeah. I got a root for the Jays. Almost won it in lacrosse, but lost Edmonton, so and the Leafs still haven't won a game yet, so we'll hold that out.
They lost to our affiliate, too, here the other day in a shootout to Ottawa. But watching the Maple Leafs growing up, did you have a favorite player?
As a kid, yeah, obviously Gretzky and whatnot, but another guy that played for Buffalo was Sergei Berezin. Love that guy. As of right now, I don't have anyone that's you know, that stands out, but I'm excited to see what McDavid and Eichel will do throughout the year.
So you were here, you know, last year, sort of the end, you know, how that atmosphere was in the locker room was pretty down. How's the atmosphere going into this year? What are some of the goals that you feel like the Iceman can accomplish this season?
A lot of confidence. Guys are, you know, they're not playing nervous with the puck. You know, when guys have the puck, like Zay or whatever, you know, even Mark, since we're on a line, there's confidence there that I trust them that they'll make a play, whether it's a pass, shot, or whatever. And it's just more relaxed in the room now that the cuts have been almost fully made. So guys are starting, you know, become more friendly with one another, opposed to wanting to beat them out of a position and whatnot. So it's a long year. So yeah, preseason, lost a couple games, but at the same time we're learning. Got rid of some guys, picked up some guys, so I'm feeling confident. They've always had a good team, Fort Wayne, but I have a feeling that we'll have a much better team.
You were here a little bit enough last year to get to know the town just a little bit. What are some of your favorite things to do in Evansville?
I used to live, I don't know what road it's on, over by the Planet Fitness. So I love that place. I'd go there every day, you get a free tan. So I did that, massage chair.
Hey, you have to look good.
Absolutely, right? Everyone's wondering why I'm tanned in Evansville. I'm like, don't worry about it. So love that. Obviously the casino. Always like to make a donation there. And you know, always be at the Ford Center.
That said, I think we have more players that make donations to the casino and we can't get them as a sponsor of the team.
We keep that place running.
I won't even go there. You sound a little...
a little steamed.
A little salty about that one?
Salty about that one.
So, what are you looking forward to here this week, Justin? Obviously, we have a busy week off the ice, too, but you guys are getting ready for the home opener. And it's been a long time coming, but what are you guys working on in practice right now to get ready?
Right now we're working on a lot of breakouts and forechecks. Obviously, if you can control the play, you know, they'll have no chance. So obviously we're working on a lot of D-zone coverage, because if they can't score goals, then you know, all we need to do worry about is putting one or two in, and then we automatically win. So a lot of defense coverage, which is really important. Sure, it might be slow at some time, just watching the other lines go and whatnot, but it has to be done. So I'll be doing that. Obviously, I had a little skate today, bit of a banger at the end, but we need it.
Saw that.
Yeah. So only one game this week, too, so there should be no excuses whether we're tired or not. So everyone's looking forward to it, definitely.
I know it's only Monday, but has Coach started breaking down Indy at all, or were there some things that you've noticed that Indy's doing well that you know, they had that 3-0 win against Quad City on Sunday. Anything that you guys have been talking about already?
No, we haven't been talking about any team specific. All I've heard is that Arsenal's not there, so that's a relief. I don't want to be the tough guy there because I know I won't be. No, nothing specific yet. That'll probably come in the next, probably by Wednesday or Thursday, and then we'll start dissecting whatever they're doing and who to look out for and whatnot, and how to beat them.
Talking about team toughness, what about Dunn so far? How do you like him? Do you feel like you're protected?
Donnie?
Yeah.
Vincent Dunn.
Oh, I thought you said Donnie Harris. That's my roommate. Vincent Dunn, yeah, he had a fight on the weekend, which, you know, looks good that he's willing to stand up for himself and as well as the logo on the front. He actually fought my older roommate, Kukali, on Fort Wayne. So I made fun of him for that. But yeah, it's always nice having guys that'll do that every now and then. I remember Mark doing it last year in Wheeling. So, you know, everyone can do it, which is nice, as long as you're not afraid to, you know, step in front and try and help the guys that are beside you. It's all that counts, just stand up for one another.
I was going to say, one game, one fight for Vincent Dunn. He's an intense guy, isn't he? He's competitive.
He is, and he's French, so it's even funnier to hear him talk.
He's from Quebec, so that's where he played in juniors last year.
Yeah, so he doesn't have the grammar down quite yet. But
we're working on it.
We're working on it, yeah. We're having speech lessons every time after practice.
I tell you what, that's a good sign, though. One thing that was mentioned about last year's team as opposed to the guys in the locker room this year is the amount of guys that are willing to fight if necessary and the toughness factor. And we, you know, you fought this weekend. Dunn fought this weekend. I think Tyson Fawcett wanted to go.
He wanted to go, yeah.
And the Fort Wayne player wouldn't go. But then I think even Steven Pirog was out there challenging guys. So
he was trying, yeah. But I think, no one wants to fight Fawcett. You never really want to fight a little guy because you know something's
wrong.
He's tough
with for a 5'7" forward.
You know something's wrong with them if they're small and they're fighting. So you just stay away.
So you're basically saying he's going to come at you like a spider monkey.
Exactly.
Let's open it up. If anybody's thought of some questions for Justin McDonald, we'd love to hear it. We got one. So the question was, with the preseason mandate the league put into play on preseason 3-on-3 overtime, regardless of the score, so you guys could get some experience in that 3-on-3 overtime, what were your thoughts on that?
I played a 3-on-3 before in overtime before. It's just a different way. I think it's awesome. You get to see guys fly down the wing, and it's always exciting for the fans because if it's a 2-on-1 one way and the goalie stops it, what's happening the other way? It's a 2-on-1 as soon as they grab the puck. So I expect there not to be a lot of games to go into shootout, just because on a 2-on-1, the odds are obviously in the players that are going to be shooting the puck. So you got to be careful, but you can draw up a quick play off a draw and just flick it down the ice, and you have a guy fast like Fawcett going, he's going to beat the defenseman every time, and it's a breakaway. So I think it's awesome. I'm looking forward to it, but hopefully it doesn't come to any overtime possibilities.
Watching it from the press box there in Fort Wayne, it was pretty interesting to see how much open ice there is with six guys.
Yeah, you don't realize how much, you know, four guys will take up the ice, but you always have to have a guy back. You can't have no guys back because you'll get scored on every time.
The mentality is different, too, depending on what coach you have or what team you have. I know for us in Fort Wayne, we went with two forwards and one D. Some teams go one forward and two defensemen, and I'm sure it'll change throughout the year, too, but did Coach Sims mention at all why the two forwards, one defenseman mentality?
Well, you always want to be kind of aggressive on him. You don't want to be sitting back the whole time. So I think that's where he's going at. And when I've done it before, it's always been two forwards, one D, sometimes three forwards, which is also, that's taking the big gamble. I wouldn't suggest 2D because you obviously want to try and score goals. You don't always want to play on the defensive side.
Right.
So. But what he did was right. Unfortunately, we didn't win that 3-on-3, but just time will come.
Any other questions for Justin McDonald? Well, thanks for coming on the show, Justin. Best of luck Saturday. Let's get a drawing of another prize here.
T-shirt! Iceman t-shirt. Reebok Iceman t-shirt.
5716236.
Here we go.
Winner!
Last week we had some issues with our raffle tickets, so we're 2 for 2 tonight. Thanks, Mac.
Thank you.
All right.
That was Justin McDonald.
All right. The man of the hour, the hat trick guy himself, Mark Antoine. AKA Mr. Gray.
Not to be called Antoine, right?
I've heard everything from Antoine to Antoine to Anthony.
And it's Antoine?
It's Antoine.
That's what I thought, okay. Point. Making sure I got that right on the media pronunciation guide. I had to make a few adjustments. Last week we thought Benny's Benjamin Deude Favé was what I just said, but that's not right. I talked to him and finally got the official pronunciation, and it's Benjamin Deude Fauvel. So from now on, hopefully I don't mess that up this year, but we have 72 tries to mess it up. So Mark Anthoyne, thanks for joining us. And first of all, having watched a lot of practices, the scrimmage, the four wing games, it's safe to say you've really done a good job standing out. And the coaches have mentioned wanting to see guys stand out to pick their final roster. What things have you been working on in your game, not only before training camp, but in the 2 weeks you've been here in Evansville?
Personally, as a player, I think I'm a pretty basic two-way player that just likes to play a defensive game, but can also try and create a little offense with a little skill. But you know, I'm just trying to better myself in all the little details of my game, because that's some of the most important stuff. Just even communication on the ice and back checking the certain areas, finishing every check, making passes on the tape, just really simple things that most people wouldn't really think about, but those can create a bigger part of your game. And so I've just tried to be crisp with everything I do. And you know, it's definitely weird being kind of, I mean, I'm 25, but there's like 20-year-olds, 21-year-olds, there's like younger guys here, 94s, 95s, and I'm a 90, so just kind of, you know, trying to set a good example with some of the other guys, and just trying to work my tail off.
It's kind of weird being 25 and feeling like the old guy, huh?
It is really weird.
So we didn't get a chance to see any hats. We had a great crowd, first of all, in Owensboro for our blue-white game. They packed the Edge Ice Center. It was awesome to see. You scored the hat trick. I don't think I saw any hats, but we didn't really make the announcement until it was a little too late. But if you do that in the Ford Center, I hope we see some hats out there.
That was Steve Rickard's fault, so I blame him.
Oh, he's not here to defend himself either.
That was a low blow. He's not even here, Ball.
I'll try and work on that for the Ford Center, but there'll probably be a lot more hats than what would be at that rink.
Yeah. We did, that's right. We announced it, but it was... sometimes you see it before the announcement's even made. They'll throw it over the glass onto the ice. But a hat trick in the scrimmage, I know that had to feel good to at least stand out, like we said, and then carry it on into Fort Wayne. You scored early in the, I think it was a first period goal on Friday.
Yeah, I mean, obviously goals can come in bunches, and if you can do the right things on the ice and do your job, and then if the points and goals and assists come, then that's great. And definitely felt good to score 3 goals. And even though it was kind of a scrimmage, you're still playing against some of your teammates who are very good players coming from all different levels. So that definitely helped the confidence a little bit. And then going into Fort Wayne, you know, I just wanted to try and keep things simple and play with some good players and, you know, kind of play to my strengths. And the team played well overall. It was back and forth. We were down 2. We came back, then they were up 2, we came back, and then it was just a really close game, so it was a good opportunity to try and do something, and you know, I thought as a whole the team looked very well this weekend, so should be interesting to see once the season gets going.
You were here towards the end of last season, we brought you back up. What are some things that maybe noticed that has been better? I sort of asked Justin the same question. How is the atmosphere different from last season to now? What are some things that you feel like this is a really good team this year?
Well, last season it's difficult because when you still have 20 or 30 games and you know you're not even close to making the playoffs, it can put a damper because obviously you play the season to try and get into the playoffs and you want to be on a championship team, but when you already know at the end of the day that you guys aren't going to be there, it's kind of like on your own. Every person is accountable to come to the rink ready to work, and you know, some guys can come in and not work hard and just try and get through the year, and then other guys could try and want to make a statement for next year. And you know, that you had a little bit of that last year. You know, it was just difficult. You know, it was a toxic environment just because we were losing. But then this year, I mean, I think there's a lot of new faces and a lot of guys trying to earn positions on the team, and I think that's good. Healthy competition is always good, creates, you know, a better team, and I think that's what we have this year. And we have a lot of speed, like you said, and some good offensive ability, and our defensive core has, I think, improved a lot, so it's good to see.
And you mentioned that kind of the poison in the locker room a little bit last year, and one thing that I've heard, and not my quote, but you know, the discussion about a loser's mentality, and once you're kind of used to it, you get into that mentality. And I haven't noticed that with this bunch in the locker room this year, and I think that speaks volumes over the guys that are in the locker room. You mentioned a lot of young, you know, new players that weren't here last year, and then those of you that were here last year, you veterans that were brought back, don't have that mentality. You guys are hungry to turn things around. The question I had was, in talking with Coach Sims and Coach Lundskog, what feedback have you gotten from them in regards to your game and coming back here to Evansville for a second year?
Funny you say that, because I'm pretty sure we have some individual player meetings tomorrow, so I wouldn't be able to tell you right now what's going on. But you know, I think they think I'm doing all right. I hope. But, you know, I'm still kicking, but. You know, I think their overall message to the whole team was that they want guys that want to play and play hard and build a championship team. And they're going to do their someone just crushed a home run. Yeah.
Twice during Mark Anthorn's interview here, Brian Ball has stood up and celebrated.
Yeah, I think he's just excited to sit next to me. I don't know.
That's it.
It is. Totally it.
I think that's the third Cubs home run of the game.
Yes, it is.
Wow. Wrigley's going crazy. So, all right, so this is a bad segue, but we're talking about other sports and hockey, and you hail from Maine. There's no pro teams in Maine. Who are the teams you grew up rooting for?
They're now affiliated with the Florida Panthers.
Oh, an affiliate. Yeah.
Portland Pirates are the America affiliates of...
I shouldn't have said pro team because that's kind of vague. I was thinking NHL, you know, Major League Baseball, NFL.
I consider myself a Boston Bruins fan and a New England Patriots and a Boston Red Sox. Yeah, I'm a New England sports fan.
So did you and Harlow have a lot in common?
I've only known him since he's been here, but we have a few mutual friends just from playing.
Gotcha.
Well, actually, you know, you and I talked about it. Really, the big thing in Maine is the Black Bears hockey program, and that's like the big thing where everyone goes to. And you know, you being a Black Bears fan, so you were like the superstar. So everyone was wanting your autograph over there, right?
No, it was a good opportunity to be able to play for the University of Maine. You know, I had some good coaching there. Made a lot of good friends, had some good teams there come through, and you know, I was able to carry that into my professional game, and you know, I'll always be indebted to them, and I appreciate that.
I was going to say, the University of Maine has so much hockey history, you know, a couple of titles, I believe, that the Correas play there, Paul Correa and his brothers, you know, and my fondest memory is probably not that of a Maine fan as being from Minnesota, the 2002 National Championship, which was Maine and Minnesota. It was one of the greatest hockey games and overtime game I've ever seen. But to go to a school that has as much history as Maine has, when you were recruited, when did you know that's where you wanted to play, and when did it hit you that you were playing for a school with that much history?
Well, that was kind of the time when they started recruiting kids a little younger. You know, they usually waited a little bit till guys were out of high school, and I was a junior in high school, and I had visited a few different schools, a few Ivy League schools and a few other schools, and I personally wanted to play in Hockey East because I thought, to me, that was my favorite league to want to play in, and I didn't think it'd be good to play anywhere other than UMaine, being from Maine. And fortunately enough, the coach at the time, Tim Whitehead, recruited me and went on a visit, and I wanted to be a Black Bear, and it was a great opportunity, and I had a great 4 years there, and it was awesome.
One thing I asked Mac earlier was about goals, and you know, the goal is always to move up. What are some goals that you want to try to accomplish this season with the Icemen?
You know, I think goals are, it's good to have broad goals and also short-term small goals, you know, that get you through the week and through the month and the year. And you know, I think overall I just want to try and have an impact on this team and stay here. And you know, the broad goal, obviously I want to be on a winning team. I've never really been on a championship team per se, so I'd love for the Icemen to do some big things this year, and that'd be awesome. If we get everyone going the right direction, then that'd be a big thing.
Let's open it up to some fans for questions for Mark Anthoine here. And we can keep asking some too up here at the table, but if you want to jump in with any questions you have for him. I'm striking out.
All right, I know we got asked this. Have you read the second book yet?
No, I have not. I'll just wait for the next movie to come out, but I can't see the movie because Phil Buschbacker's in Hungary. So,
what I'm out of loop. Maybe, is this the 50 Shades of Grey story?
Yes, I. They asked last season what I did on Valentine's Day, and I somehow Phil Buschbacker got it out of us that we went to the movies and saw 50 Shades of Grey together, just me and my teammate. So. Maybe my girlfriend will be available to see the next one with me, but I don't know.
Good cover. Hey, at least you're honest about it. Some people would deny it.
Yeah. Well, now that I'm called Mr. Gray all the time around here. That I did.
Question from the audience. Becca, you got anything? How did Mark do this weekend?
Come on, Becca.
He did good. He didn't play while we were there.
That's right. Mark had to share his jersey with Sebastian Strandberg this weekend. So he got to play Friday, and Strandberg played his first game Saturday. But Friday night's game, a lot of comebacks for you guys. Down 2-0, came back, tied the game before the end of the first period. Down 4-2, came back, tied the game going into the second intermission, and then couldn't do it a third time, but came within a goal there at the end. That type of a game, does that build character, the resiliency to be able to, when you're down by a couple of goals, be able to come back, knowing that you can do it now going forward?
Absolutely. You know, winning teams know how to face adversity, and you know, when you're down one goal, two goals, even three goals, you know, you show your true colors when the going gets tough. And I think us coming back, being down two goals, and then them going up ahead two more goals, and us coming back, you know, it shows a lot about what we have here, you know, because it's easy to give up in certain situations, but, you know, as long as you come together as a team, you know, a few fights, Macker, Dunner had a nice fight, and, you know, we had some goals, and, you know, I thought it looks good.
A lot of these fans are obviously big fans of Dalton Levier from being an Evansville Iceman a couple years ago, and now he's back. You got to play on a line with him in that game on Friday, and I believe your goal, it was a power play goal, and he took it coast to coast, really, from one end of the ice to the other, and then you picked up the rebound and scored. But what was it like playing with Dalton Levier?
Yeah, he's a good player. Actually, I had the opportunity to play with him for a few games, like four or five games at the end of my college season. I came and played here for a little bit, and then he was gone last season. But you know, it's good to see a familiar face who's been in the Iceman jersey, and he's a very skilled player, good hands, good vision, and skates very well. So you know, it's easy to play with good players. You know, you just have to be in the right place at the right time, and they'll do the job for you.
What is a team that you really want, you know, really get back at from last season? What's a sort of like a revenge game?
I don't know. We didn't always cope well with Indy, so You know, I think they're our little rivals, I guess.
I'm telling you, I think this Indy Fuel rivalry is going to grow into something big because they're so new in this league, and they're the closest Indiana team to us that if we can match that Fort Wayne rivalry someday, I think it'll be awesome to have some good battles with Indy. Any other questions for Mark and Thoyne? Well, we have a rivalry with both. But obviously the Fort Wayne rivalry, I think when I ask the question, has a little bit more bitterness to it, am I right? Any other questions for Mark? Well, Mark, we appreciate it. Great job in training camp and in scrimmage
and
preseason games. And best of luck to you. Mark and Thoyne. Oh, Mark, come back.
Oh, yes, yes.
Let's draw for a prize.
Draw for a prize. Let's get an old Iceman puck head.
5-7-1-6-2-6-1.
All right.
Do we have a winner? All right.
Actually, do you want a puck head or you want a $10 gift card to get some more golf balls? Yeah, there's a $10 gift card to Playing Against Sports for golf balls. You need something. Yes, yes. So take that. We'll give you.
I had a feeling that was going to be your choice. Thanks to the three guys coming down here to Beef O'Brady tonight, and we hope you enjoyed those interviews. We look forward to talking to those guys soon, whether it be on a radio broadcast throughout the year or back here at Beef O'Brady. So we've got a lot more to cover, though. We mentioned the breaking news earlier with the additions and the subtractions to the roster. If my math serves me, I think we're at 24 now, and by Wednesday we have to be at 23, and then we have 30 days throughout the regular season to hold 23 players on the roster. But the additions again, Matt Hussey and Ryan Penny, and then of course the subtractions this weekend, Matt Harlow, Radoslav Ilo, JP Lombardo, and Robin Sudek. Speaking of Binghamton, we do want to talk a little bit about our affiliates here. Binghamton did play their opener this week. And it was a big 4-1 win for the Senators, so it was a good start for them up there. And of course, we want to support those guys because they support us as well. And if everybody's healthy in Binghamton, and we get to keep a lot of these talented players here, of course, we're selfish. We get to keep a lot of these talented players in Evansville, but I'm sure we'll see some up and down from both sides.
And also big with Drieger made 32 saves and only gave up one goal that night, so it's good to see Chris Drieger, former Iceman, doing well back up at Binghamton.
And so they're 1-0 with that 4-1 win. It was the Albany Devils who were in town to take on Binghamton, and you mentioned Drieger had a nice night. Their opening night roster featured obviously Drieger and Scott Grenham, who played some time for the Iceman last year on that opening night roster. Guy Lapine was on that opening night roster.
Did Guy behave himself that game?
You know, I didn't see if there was any issues.
Yeah, he behaved himself. Yeah, he tried. Yeah, I would run from him too. So big scary guy.
But so they went 4-1. They did name their captain, too, up there in Binghamton. And now, I didn't ask any of the guys I was meaning to do that. We haven't named our captains. Is that right? Nobody yet? Did you guys vote on it on the bus trip? Is that what was going on? Okay. I saw slips of paper going around for everybody. Ah, gotcha. So we don't have our captains named yet, but when they are, we'll make a big announcement. Binghamton did name their captain. Looking for that press release here. I had it in front of me. Here we go. It's a veteran by the name of Zach Stortini. So he'll be the captain of the Binghamton Senators this year, veteran forward. And he's beginning his 11th season of pro hockey. He signed a 2-year, two-way contract with Ottawa on July 1st, so he can be called up and then sent back down without having to go through waivers. But he'll be the captain of the Binghamton Senators this year, or Bingo as we like to call it. I still got to catch on to that. Nice little shortening way of saying it.
Well, plus, I usually butcher it, so it's nice I can say Bingo instead of saying the other word.
The assistant captains, from the looks of it, at home will be Mark Frazier and Patrick Mullen, the alternate captains. On the road, it'll be Eric Odell and Michael Koska. So I don't know if we'll be doing something along those lines with a set captain and then two alternates at home and two alternates on the road. Kind of like that, actually, but I know a lot of teams just keep it consistent throughout the whole season.
I think Alex would kill Johan if he does anything like that. It makes him stitch more letters on jerseys. So
Alex would?
Alex would. Alex would beat him.
Johan specifically? Is that his
choice? Oh, yeah, beat Johan because he won't go up against Al, but he'll definitely beat Johan. There would definitely be a fight in the locker room for that.
Yeah. We also should talk about the Ottawa Senators briefly. They played three games we mentioned. They won their opener against the Buffalo Sabres, and the big story there was Jack Eichel, the highly touted rookie out of Boston University, played his first career NHL game for the Sabres, but Ottawa went in and beat him 3-1, and Kyle Turris had two goals for the Senators. Mike Hoffman had a couple assists. It was a good start to the year. And then the Senators won again on the road in Toronto, and I know a lot of our players and coaches weren't, you know, they're happy because we're affiliates with Ottawa, but they grew up Toronto Maple Leafs fans. We beat them in a shootout 5-4, so 2-0 to start the season for the Ottawa Senators. Things didn't go so well in the last game against Montreal, a 3-1 loss.
Hey, I told you, Mike Babcock just went to Toronto because he knows he can go play golf early.
And that looks to be the case with the team that's out there on the ice. That and the money, you're right. So a good start for some of the individual Senators. We've talked about it, that the goaltending situation in Ottawa, we think, is going to be Craig Anderson and Andrew Hammond, but Hammond's injured for a couple weeks, so O'Connor's up there, the rookie they signed out of Boston University, with Craig Anderson, meaning Driedger and Grenham, two guys who played for the Icemen, are in Binghamton. At some point, if everybody's healthy, I'm sure we'll see Grenham, from the sounds of it, down here in Evansville.
Yeah, definitely Grimp's going to be a great plug for us, but at the same time, as you know, I think you and I both have heard it from Al that we are going to carry three goalies, because you just don't know what's going to happen, you know, here in Evansville. So I think, you know, you got Comer, he's going to sit in there and back up, and you know, Comer has shown that'd be a solid number two goalie for us, you know, when the time comes. And then you got Bixberg. Did I pronounce that right, Dev?
Bixberg. Yep.
You know, I tell you what, you know, I refereed that training camp game, and I think he's going to do great things for us. Man, he hates to get scored on. Man, if he gets scored on, he wants to chop someone's head off with that goalie stick. So I mean, that shows a lot of great things for goaltending. But how did Matt O'Connor do? Did he get any of the games, or was it Anderson all games?
I think Anderson played all three, if I'm not mistaken. So he did against Montreal. Okay, thank you. He played against the Canadiens, and then Montreal didn't start Carey Price that game either. They had their backup and he won that game. So Montreal's going to be a tough team. They were good last year, and a lot of folks thought they were a Stanley Cup contender, and they're going to be good again this year. They're one of those defensively stingy teams that it's going to be tough to score against with Carey Price and PK Subban and some of those guys they have in there. Last year, the biggest concern with them was their scoring, but they figured it out until the playoffs when Ottawa came through. But so let's talk about the goaltending briefly. Still won, but you know, Ottawa gave them a couple good games in there. Chris Bengtsson, you mentioned the Swede who we brought over to play goalie. You mentioned Brandon Kamm. Let's talk about it a little bit. You know, you look at the stat sheet. If you didn't watch the game, obviously we didn't have the game broadcasted, so we didn't have the radio broadcast or the video for folks from Fort Wayne. So you look at the stat sheet and you see, you know, we lost 6-5 up there in Fort Wayne. I would say this. I think at least four of those goals were not Chris Bengtsson's fault. Some rebounds that you expect to be cleared away. It wasn't the case. Couple power plays where he was screened on the shot, rebound kicks out, and it's tapped in. I thought he played a better game than the stats show, so I'll say that. I thought there are definitely some good signs there with Bengtsson, and obviously he was brought over here for a reason. So I really like, you mentioned his how much he hates getting scored on, and you love to have a goalie like that who you can see that competitiveness come out as he's playing the game. The key is not letting your highs get too high and not letting your lows get too low. When you're having a rough night, not getting too low, and when you're playing really well, not getting a big head, right? You know you're a goalie. This is your time to jump in.
Being I'm a goalie? Really? No, I haven't been a goalie for a long time, but no, I still like to play a little basic. But no, if you got a goalie that is very competitive, shows heart, you know, that a lot of big things that are going to come this year. I like him. I mean, he's solid. I mean, he stays straight to the shooter. So he takes up a lot in net, so I think we're going to see a lot of great things from him. You know, the big thing is to worry about European goaltenders just a little bit. This is just my opinion. Don't take it to heart. You play in those bigger rinks in Europe, and so that's going to be the thing. And actually, Johan even said it too, is just make sure, and he thinks he can. He's a young goalie, very very athletic. He's just getting used to back to the smaller rinks instead of the bigger rinks and over in Europe. That's the one big thing. Make sure he does.
And Brandon Kalm played Saturday night, and I thought he played really well in the first two periods. I think he played well throughout the game. Obviously, things kind of fell apart in that third period. We got outshot heavily in the third. Fort Wayne outshot us. I think it was 20-6 in the third period. And we were already down 3-1 at that point. So on the scoreboard, things didn't look great, losing 6-2, but I thought Brandon Kalm made some huge saves on Saturday in Fort Wayne. I was really impressed with his game. So both goalies did do some good things. Brian shaking his head. Cardinals just hit a home run here.
Two-run home run.
You're still winning, Brian. Quit whining.
Quit whining. Defensively, though, a couple players that stood out to me, and again, one man's opinion, I'm not relaying anything, it's just from what I saw. I thought Andrew Himmelson, the player we brought on last week, if you were here, anybody that was here last week, I thought he played a really nice couple of games in Fort Wayne. He's so smart with the puck. I really like what he brings to the table. He's the player we traded for with the Greenville Swamp Rabbits.
And, Swamp Rabbits!
And he doesn't have to,
down the bunny trail.
And he doesn't have to wear one of those jerseys.
Yeah, he did not want to wear one of those jerseys this year.
And Chris Carlisle is going to be a good young defenseman. He's 20, that Ottawa picked up as a free agent. He played for the Oshawa Generals last year, so he's used to winning. Oshawa won the Memorial Cup, which is a huge, huge deal in Canada. And we're happy to have him in Evansville. He scored a goal on Friday, but I thought he looked good pretty much all weekend. And he's a guy that's definitely someone to watch for defensively. And I guess you weren't there, so this is kind of my
This is all you. I had spiel. Nothing to I was following your tweets, and I was trying to watch the Cubs game, and you were talking about Napa replay, and I tweeted something about some male enhancement replay, so that's a Cubs game I was watching. They had some type of replay cam going for that. So was, yeah.
Well,
so, I was following you. I was following you on Twitter. You did a good job.
We were talking a little about the sponsorships. Oh, you like the Twitter thing? Okay. I'm glad you enjoyed it. I thought that was a nice thing to do since we didn't get a chance to I would have liked to have broadcasted it, obviously, being a broadcaster, but it was fun to get to do the play-by-play on Twitter for everybody, so hopefully that was well-received, because that was fun to get to do that.
Well, and actually, there's going to be a question from Stacy right here, but actually, Travis Toratori, we're over here, he's actually going to be tweeting during Iceman games at home this season, so you can actually follow us on Twitter during Iceman home games as well. And Stacy, question for you.
You do like that? We can pass these around too. This is just a sample from this weekend, but I posted that on Twitter before the game. I spent 6 hours on the bus ride to Fort Wayne putting this thing together from scratch on Photoshop, from nothing. And the main reason was, for the media that's attending and for the opposing team, it's nice for them to have our lines because they give us their lines in some way, shape, or form. And I've seen this done at the college level and in the pro level, so I wanted to do this. And we'll make sure to post that every game. We'll have our line combinations on our Twitter page. In the scratches, yep, and the starting goaltender. So that's the plan. I'm kind of really nerdy when it comes to statistics. That's if you get to know me a little bit. I'm a stats guy.
Nerd.
And even things like this, I'm pretty nerdy about. So, yeah, we'll make sure to keep doing that. And for me, it's kind of cool to be able to see the difference in line combinations and who's starting. And, you know, I got the pronunciation guide on there, which is kind of nice since help myself out a little bit more than anything. But
well, and also one thing is also fans, we're actually doing a lineup poster. This will actually be on the back of the poster. But what we're doing with the TRCI Autograph Zone this year, you can buy a $2 game note program. It's like instead of the game note programs from last year, but we're doing a poster with the three guys that are going to autograph that night. And we're going to put this on the back of it for $2 and sell those at the game so the kids can actually get those autographed. And then also you get the most up-to-date stats on that for each game, too.
And we don't know who our three players will be for the opener yet, but we'll get three guys for the autographs after the game for the home opener. And on that note, we might as well mention it now. The big season ticket holder event is tomorrow night already.
Yes.
And so season ticket holders can come down to Old National Bank Plaza, am I right?
Yep, from 6 to 8 tomorrow night. Doors open up at 5:30. Sort of going to be a autograph session during that time, and then sort of then after that, you're doing a program, and hopefully you don't say nice a lot. And that's all, folks. Try your best. But hopefully we're going to talk with Johan and maybe some type of entertainment from the rookies, possibly, maybe.
We're going to, yeah.
We haven't had that conversation yet, but we're going
to
try.
We'd like to have the rookies, since there are a lot of them, put on a little skit or a talent show or something if we can. So we'll have to see if that's possible on short notice. But the good news is the whole team's going to be there. All the coaches will be there. We'll introduce everybody, and we'll have kind of a question and answer type format. So it'll be fun tomorrow to get to meet some of those guys and to see all the season ticket holders out. We're looking forward to it.
Also, we'll have about four or five really nice raffle prizes as well. So, you know, sign up. We'll give everyone a raffle ticket that enters. And also at the same time, we'll have a question bowl. So if you have any type of question that you want to answer, we'll pull out your question and ask that to one of the players, to the player of your choice. Becca, get your questions ready for me. No? No answer, once again. It'll be a fun night tomorrow night. Also, if you are hungry or thirsty, the deli will be open as well. It's a restaurant inside of the Old National Bank headquarters. That'll be open as well. If you need a soft drink or something like that, they will be open for that.
The other event we do want to mention, we talked to the guys about how busy this week was, not only on the ice, but off the ice. Just kind of par for the course, I guess, for being training camp and getting ready for the first game of the season. So in the office, as Travis and Brian can attest to, it's a lot of long days this week to get ready for the home opener, but that's the fun part about working in sports. And the players, too, have a lot going on. We have the season ticket holder event on tomorrow night. We have our media day, which is for the local media at the arena tomorrow. And then
That's Wednesday. Just
Wednesday, I'm sorry.
No, mess up your dates.
See, I'm already getting turned around. Wednesday, we have our media day scheduled, but then there's the golf scramble on Thursday, which had to be pushed back because of weather like we had today. So hopefully, knock on wood, we have good weather on Thursday.
I saw it's nice and sunny, but rain or shine, we're playing. we've already had our pushback date already, so rain or shine, we're playing. We got about 14 teams right now. If you still want to come out and play, it's like $112.50 for a single person, or it's $450 a team. Great night. We got lunch provided by Domino's at 12:30. Lunch will be at 11:30. We're going to tee off at 12:30, and then a nice dinner and prizes afterwards. Got a lot of great, nice raffle prizes to give away that evening. So a great night at Cambridge Golf Course on Thursday with the players. The players are excited about playing. Each team will have a hockey player that plays with them. Coach Al Sims' team, I think he's already declared victory. I don't know whose team he's on yet, but I think he's already declared he's going to win. So
I don't know. Johan talks a big game, too. So
Johan's been using my clubs and has been killing it with my driver. So I think he's excited about, he says if he gets a couple of Coors Lights in him, he's going to definitely win. So
See, my key is to limit the Coors Lights, and I'm in good shape. It'll be a fun Thursday out at the golf course for us, and the nice thing is then we're 2 days from the home opener at the Ford Center against Indy, and for one, being a diehard hockey fan and very excited about this first season for me in Evansville, I've been having this date circled since I accepted the job. This is going to be a fun night, I think.
Well, it's going to be your big ECHL debut. You've earned it. You've done a great job. We're looking forward to seeing you broadcast or listening to broadcast. Not seeing you, unless you're going to be on TV or something.
No, got a face for radio.
But let's talk a little bit about Saturday night. One thing does get kicked off at 1:00. It's going to be the Coors Light tailgate party at backstage, and I was so excited. Coors Light went out and bought us Sauce Toss. If you have not seen Sauce Toss, it's a new hockey craze, hockey game that's out there. It's like cornhole, but with hockey sticks and hockey pucks. So Coors Light went out and bought us a couple of Sauce Toss boards. So that'll be going on during the Coors Light tailgate party. Also, there's going to be live bands and music all day downtown. So definitely a good kickoff. They have a beer run going on during that time as well. So they'll have the beer run downtown. But at the same time, they're also gearing up to kick us off. So a lot of good parties going downtown on Saturday night. That's one thing I want to talk about.
Yeah, no, that's good to get that. It's a busy day leading up to the game. So, I mean, obviously the 7:15 is circled on the calendar, but there's a lot going on before that for fans to take it all in, because it seems like the best time of year other than the playoffs is the pregame festivities for the first game of the season, because you're really getting energized for hockey to be back. We have a question back there. Yes,
season ticket holder entrance. We can bring up a little bit on that. Right there, it's like the will call entrance that you see right next to the will call window. We used it for like big groups and stuff like that. This year, Greer's Flooring went and sponsored it. There's going to be a red carpet. There will be a sign that states out that season ticket holder entrance. You guys can go into there. Basically, we'll have your guys' promo items right there, so you can go right into there. Just show your season ticket. One of the season ticket reps will be right there as well. Also, on October 24th, Domino's Pizza is giving every season ticket holder half, nine games, full season, a one large carryout-only pizza on the October 24th game. So every person will get a large carryout-only pizza by Domino's. So we're also coming up with other great ways to find out rewards through our sponsors to give out to our fans through that season ticket holder entrance. We have a great magnetic calendar. Everyone's like, oh my gosh, it's a magnetic calendar. I already got one of those. No, this one actually, we designed it pretty cool this year. You can pop out the schedule and you can use the Iceman magnetic calendar as a frame. So you can it'll be a nice Iceman frame that you can put your picture on, put that up on the refrigerator so the schedule pops out, so a nice little Iceman. And that's presented by Deaconess Hospital. Deaconess Hospital helped support that and paid to have all those magnetic calendars done, and done really nice this year. So we're excited about the magnetic calendar giveaway. Also, speaking of some other promos that we got going on this year, one thing is starting tomorrow, we got a new sponsor on called District 7. District 7, there you're doing, calling a, we're going to call it like the selfie of the game. District 7, if you go to their place and take a picture of yourself in their place, you have a chance to win 4 tickets to an Iceman game and a $10 off coupon. District 7 and a selfie. So if you guys are into fashion, into clothes, a new boutique clothing store has opened up. District 7 became a great new partner of ours. They are doing a selfie. Go on out there. Travis will be posting about that on Facebook tomorrow. Also, another thing that we're watching this year is Bleacher, the Bleacher app. It's an in-game social media game, and you answer trivia questions, you post pictures, and you gain points for prizes, and then at the end of the night we'll take the top three winners and we'll get them a prize pack from our different sponsors. So that's our Bleacher app. Basically, Coors Light. They have no longer sponsored our radio show, but they have gone on to sponsor the Bleacher app. They are doing the Coors Light Social and the Coors Light Cheers. So you got to show your Coors Light at the Ford Center, cheering each other, or doing an Iceman Social, which will make those announcements. And you can buy your ice cold Coors Light at the C.H. Robinson bar. So definitely got to get my post to Coors Light, because they're still a great partner, even though they backed off on sponsoring our radio show, which is now still we can purchase. Also, other programs that we're talking about, Kite Home Center, Lucky Lumber is still in, so you get your receipts and the chance to win an autographed hockey stick. And Travis will probably be talking about this a little bit more, but we're also doing something, sort of like we're bringing back that Bar Louie event that where we drew out a number and sort of like the biggest knucklehead of the night or something like that. That guy got a penalty on the visiting team. Everyone got a free appetizer. Well, anyways, TGI Fridays has sponsored that. And so they're going to give away, if that guy gets a penalty, this first one get a penalty or something like that, that we draw a number out of a bucket. Everyone in the tents will get a free appetizer from TGI Fridays. So that's another new promo that's going on this year. And I got a... And all right. Oh, we got a happy birthday. Alan, you want to come up here? Well, all right, we got to sing happy birthday to Alan before we leave. All right.
Alan Rhodes.
How old are you going to be? Officially. 35 years.
35 tomorrow. All happy right. Birthday.
Happy birthday. And it's got the cutest little girl over there, too. All right. Well, anyways, those are some of the new promotions that are coming up. We also will be also doing some other things as well, but those are some of the new promotions going on this coming hockey season. Anything else? I'm sort of wrapping my part up.
Well, we only have a couple of minutes left. I was going to open it up for questions if there were any. If not, I can ramble for a couple minutes, but... yeah.
Yes, we're back at Bar Louie this year. Travis has been trying to work with Wes, trying to find out what the dates are we're actually going to put the parties on. But yes, we'll be doing, I think it's 5 parties part of their contract each year. But other than that, they will be showing every away game at Bar Louie. So, and hopefully things are better this year. That's nothing to do with Bar Louie. That's hopefully the team's got better internet. I know one thing is a league mandate this year. Everyone had to go to HD cameras, which we went to HD cameras as well. So hopefully the video picture is a lot better at some of these arenas. Now, I can't say anything about Kalamazoo or South Carolina. Those were always the two tough ones. It wasn't so much the cameras, it was their internet. So, it just really depends on the arena. So.
And hopefully the broadcaster doesn't butcher any names.
Actually, we changed over to the other guy.
Otherwise, you're taking over and going on the road. Any other questions regarding events coming up, things that are happening this year regarding the Icemen, such as the viewing parties, maybe Fort Wayne this past weekend, what I was able to see, and anything like that?
How is Bob Chase?
Bob, I tell you what, the broadcaster for the Fort Wayne Comets is a legend. And a great guy, just one of the nicest guys. He actually mentored Doc Emmerich, Mike Emmerich, who is now the number one play-by-play guy in television for the NHL. And Bob is turning 90 this year, and he's still broadcasting Comets games. He's not going on the road as much at all, really, but he's doing the home games. And I, being where I'm at in my career, first year in pro hockey, and meeting a guy like Bob was really cool for me, just because. I'm a sponge. I asked him for advice and how he's able to do it that long, and he's certainly a legend and a well-known voice. He may broadcast for our rivals. I know we don't like the Comets, but let's hear it. But Bob Chase is a class act, and I was really lucky I got a chance to meet him. So that's pretty much going to wrap things up for us again. We appreciate you guys coming down to Beef Up Brady in Newburgh tonight. Big thanks to our three players tonight who came down, Mark Anthoyne, Justin McDonald, and Matthew Zay. We'll get a few new players or coaches on Monday next week, but by then we'll have a recap for you on our home opener, which the season starts officially on Saturday. Ford Center against the Indy Field. We hope to see you all there. And for those of you listening, we hope to see you out at the Ford Center. We're looking forward to it. Thank you so much for coming down tonight.
Thank you all.